Many, many thanks to Sharon Laborde for sharing Welcome to the Conversation, Writing the Arts and the Creative Spirit. We hope to have Sharon back with us often. Thanks also to Dr. Jim Young for Be Here Now. Next up is Champion Jack Dupre singing Bad Health Blues. Then Jane and Richard take us on a walk through a list of winter chores that includes plucking chickens, leavened by good neighbors who share tools. Now, here's Champion Jack Dupre.
Richard, it certainly feels like winter. Just last weekend brought our first snow and ice, and last night we received our first single-digit temperatures. Every season has a different need for preparation, but it seems to me that winter takes more preparation than the other seasons. We've already talked about putting the garden to bed, but I still have a lot of mulching to do. We also turned the compost pile one last time before spring to incorporate the frostbitten plants and other plant debris, as well as leaves and chicken litter. We also pick up leaves in Holiday Island and Eureka Springs every year. Some people call us every year and ask us to come pick up their leaves.
Well, we've made a good relationship with a lot of folks in the urban areas around us that need to get rid of their leaves and are happy to. Some of them collect some eggs from us and barter other things and are happy to have us come and get the leaves out of their yard after they bag them, of course.
Yes. We use leaves to make compost, to chop up and use for mulch, and to build soil. We also use them as litter in the chicken house. The girls really appreciate a nice thick mulch of organic matter when the winds are blowing outside and they can't get out. The mulch helps keep the chickens nice and warm, and it composts their droppings. They are industrious enough to scratch around in there and keep the mulch turned, and in return it keeps them warm and keeps them clean. We also put a light on a timer in the chicken house, so they will continue laying eggs all winter. We have done some young chickens this year, and hopefully we'll have lots of eggs.
It seems to be working out so far. They're laying quite well, aren't they?
Right now they are. That's good. Richard, you built a woodshed this year that's just beautiful, and fortunately, it's full of wood. Can you tell us a little bit about your arrangement with some of the neighbors to help get that woodshed full?
Well, I would. I started the woodshed, and not being a professional builder, again, the neighborhood came together, and I got some great advice and some wonderful help from a professional builder that lives right down the road and is, honored to say, a good friend. That happened better than it would have if I'd have done it myself. And then other neighbors needed to collect wood as well. And we had an opportunity to go out together, and we worked as a team, the three of us, and were able to cut some trees that have been dead for several years and were just right and cured already for firewood, dropped the trees. The team was able to pick up the detritus, the branches that weren't good for wood, and pile them so that they can be taken care of in a neat and easier way. We collected the wood together and split it, and now both families have plenty of wood for the winter.
When the old hardware store closed several years ago and the new hardware store opened up, they sold the old wood splitter because they wanted to buy a new one.
Yeah, it was slightly damaged, and I was fortunate enough to be first in the queue line and got to purchase that and do the little bit of repairs needed, and it's been a real blessing to us and the rest of the neighborhood. We've kind of followed, because of our community that we've developed here, the ability to share tools. It wasn't like when I lived in the city and the neighbor borrowed my wrenches and moved away and I never saw him again. Here everybody cooperates, and remember the old days when people combined, and not everybody owned a combine, the town did or a community did, and everybody got together and help put up the hay and do all of that, but not everybody owned big tools. It just wasn't necessary. And we're kind of in that situation in a smaller way here. I think it's great.
Another big tool we borrowed recently was a chicken plucker.
Oh, the great chicken plucker.
Well, it certainly has revolutionized butchering chickens. We had 29 chickens to butcher this year, and believe me, plucking 29 chickens in cold weather by hand is very unpleasant. However, you just plug in the chicken plucker, attach a hose to it, throw the chicken in, and in about a minute that you have a pile of washed chicken feathers and a perfectly plucked chicken.
Yeah, and again, we process the chickens in cooperation with our neighbors.
We had another couple down the road that owned half the chickens. Then we had three neighbors from across the street, and our friend Mary Pat came and helped, and we had a great time visiting and put up 29 chickens.
Yeah, it's become a difficult job still, but a social gathering and a lot of fun.
We pile wood on our porch for easy snow-free access. My dog and I take a walk every morning and gather kindling as we walk. I pick up sticks, Spot runs with them for a short while and then needs a new stick. I also gather pine cones for fire starting and cut up scraps of lumber in the shop. I use all of these things along with junk mail to start our fires. One of the hardest tasks of getting ready for winter is the big clothing switch out, putting the summer clothes away and dragging out the winter clothes. That takes me at least 2 days and some amount of cussing before I get it done, but it's done now, and having warm pants and coats to go out and do the chores in is very welcome.
Well, part of that, and I thank you for doing it, is we have a 30 by 30 foot log home that is two stories, so there's plenty of room, but the storage and closet space is minimal, and I can't even get in some of those spaces that you do, and I really appreciate you doing that switch out every season.
My favorite winter changeover involves food. Goodbye, fresh tomatoes, peppers, eggplant, and beans. Hello, chicken and dumplings, chili of various kinds, beef stew, oxtail soup, split pea soup, baked sweet potatoes and squash, savory lentil and rice dishes, and cornbread. I heartily recommend two books by a former Eureka Springs writer, Crescent Dragon Wagon, for winter meals. The Cornbread Gospels. My favorite is Aunt Sylvia's Ozark Cornbread on page 18. The other book I love is called Bean by Bean, and is my favorite recipe is one called Mjedra on page 301. Both are very savory, easy to make, and warm and comforting. So, for this season, I have made already split pea soup, chicken and dumplings, out of my old 1970s Farm Journal cookbook. Richard Potter at the Eureka Springs Farmers Market has some great soup bones and meat, but I'm still waiting for my oxtails. I've also made ham and beans and mushrooms and venison.
And all of it quite good. And as you can tell by my girth, I've eaten all of it.
My favorite winter activity by far is reading books. I love to look over my bookshelves and decide what I want to read every day. I love and have many nonfiction books, but I also love fiction and reread my favorites about every 3 years. I also go to the Eureka Springs Library, a beautiful building with a beautiful and helpful staff, and get a bag of books every week. I especially appreciate their nonfiction newly published books, and I've learned a lot of things I never thought I would by reading those books. So I'm just going to gather these nice books around my chair, put my feet up, drink a cup of coffee, and watch the snow.
The Ozark Harvest Radio Hour is a production of the Eureka Springs Independent and the Inside Straight and Thanatopsis Club. Richard Pille, executive producer. Dan Croats, producer and writer. Dr. Sharon Sloan, technical director. Dr. Fred Mayer, director of music. G.K. Chesterton, director of philosophy and content. Jane Pille and Bonifaci Fiacre Gardening Consultants, Luca Brasi, Aquaculture Consultant, Eddie Kiever and the Fabulous Kiever Sisters, Advertising and Sales, and Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young for reminding us of when we were young. The Ozark Harvest Radio Hour is organic radio, always fresh, always local, and always honest. We are community radio. That means that if you would like to appear on the Ozark Harvest Radio Hour, we have to put you on. Contact us at theozarkharvestradiohour.com, like us on Facebook, or look us up in the telephone book. Until next week, so long, and be nice.
One, two, three, four.